to invite Wynn LaRue to come on up. And we can kind of give Wynn, as many of you know, Wynn, a member of this congregation, a member of this community, long time, has been involved with the youth and different programs, but she's also a comedian and has been involved with one of the, I guess you're about to get involved with Second Cities, one of their groups.
Correct.
And so she's been living up in New York and doing improv and stuff there. And so she's with us.
Hi.
Welcome.
Hello.
I don't know if you want this in front of you. You can move that to the side. Here's my conversation with Wynn this morning. So excited for today. Hooray. Me too. Glad you're joining in. Thanks for inviting me. Where are you? I'm on my way.
Here.
Why aren't you here? I'm on my way, friend. Ah! And she's here. All right.
quick question. Has anything not ever happened on time for anyone else in the room?
Uh-huh.
Embodiment.
That's right. Another embodiment for you.
Another
That's right.
Embodiment.
So what we were going to do today is very improvisational in some ways as well.
Uh-huh.
Yes, please take that mic. I meant to bring the handheld, but you can use that
okay.
one. Yeah. We want, and also online, Brad is kind of monitoring online on Facebook. If you are online and want to ask a question, Brad will be there to also... There you go. So Brad will also be there to ask your questions, so feel free to raise that. Some of you have been reading the blog posts. Some of you have been with us the last few Sundays as we've been looking at this series of what it means to sort of lean into the journey of the heroine as opposed to the journey of the hero and how that lines up with Jesus' teachings. And so what I wanted to do is to start off with a little fable that comes out of the Sufi tradition. And if you're looking around and noticing the images that we've been using and the quotes that we've been using before the service and what we'll use here, and the music you've been listening to, the Wishful Thinking, the great song Pearl Jam, thank you, yeah. Wishful Thinking, this kind of, I wish. What is the heroine's journey that invites us that's different from the hero's journey? Most of us live by the hero's journey. Most of our culture, our country is centered around the hero's journey. It's not a bad thing. We need that sense of, we need to conquer things, we need to achieve things, we need to fix things. It also becomes, unfortunately, the defining myth of our culture, so that a lot of our culture is oriented around then consumption. And consumption becomes kind of like our defining myth. We don't have enough, not enough success, not enough, not the right relationship, not enough myself, I'm not right, something wrong with me, not enough hair.
Not enough time,
yeah. We get caught up in these myths of scarcity, and then it gets defined in much larger ways if you look at our culture, and the Western culture, and our world. So what's different about that? So here's a little story that comes out of the Middle Eastern Islamic mystical tradition. We've used some Sufi stories in here before. There was a merchant who lived far off in a beautiful city over in the Middle East years and years and years ago. And he had a beautiful bird which he kept in a cage. And the bird had deep blue feathers and gray-tipped wings. And all day long, the bird would sing, I want to fly away free from my cage. I want to fly away free from my cage. I want to fly away. I'm going to be free someday. I want to fly away free from my cage. She would sing this song every single day. Until one day, the merchant who had found her in a faraway region said, you know what? I listen to you sing this song every day. I'm going to be going back to that region where I had found you. And since I'm going back there, I thought maybe I could take a message. And of course, she began flapping her wings and she said, take a message, take me. Take me back to my home. And he said, no. You belong in the cage. That's why I found you and caught you and put you in the cage, so I could hear your beautiful song every day. But I'll be happy to tell them something. And she said, well, then at least tell them that I'm alive and I'm here. And so he agreed. A few days later, when he reached that realm and into those trees in that forested region, he was looking around for some other things, but he heard a song up in the treetops. And it sounded very much like his own bird. And when he looked up, he saw a bird with deep blue feathers and gray-tipped wings. And he thought, I found another. So he said, I just wanted to tell you something. I have one of your friends, perhaps a relative of yours, who knows, but she sings every day the same beautiful song, and I wanted you to know that she wanted you to know that she's with me and she's fine. And at that moment, before he could even get back on his horse and ride back into the city to the marketplace, he saw the bird suddenly turn lifeless and fall down to the ground, hit the ground with a thud. When he went over and he nudged the bird, she didn't move a feather, she didn't make a sound. And immediately he thought to himself, how terrible. How horrible. Just I only meant to bring a happy note, and here I've broken this bird's heart, and it's died. He didn't know how he was going to break the news to his own bird, but when he returned back to his own home after a few more days, his own bird was once again singing in the cage. I want to fly away free from my cage. I want to fly away free from my cage. I want to fly someday. I'm going to be free in some way. I want to fly. I want to fly away. I'm changing it up as we go along. Yeah.
I've been listening to this song since I was 3 years old, so I know he's making something up on the fly.
Yeah.
Get it on the fly. I'm a professional. Go ahead, Tom.
So he goes in, and he says to the bird, I found one of your birds. That was exciting, but I'm sorry to tell you, sad news, as soon as I gave the bird the message you gave me, that's what you told me to say, the bird fell from the tree lifeless, landed on the ground, and must have died from a broken heart. I wish I could have brought better news back. And as the merchant himself turned to walk away from the cage, his own bird suddenly fell lifeless from her own perch with a thud to the bottom of the cage. The merchant heard the sound. He went back and he shook the cage, and the bird was lifeless, wasn't making a sound. He opened up the cage and he looked at the bird and picked her up in his hands to see if there was a heartbeat. And as soon as he had picked her up in his hands, the bird quickly jumped up, spread her wings, and flew off through the window. And as she got further into the trees, she looked back and she said, you didn't bring me bad news. You brought me glad news, because in the words and the actions of my friends, I found my way to freedom. We could sing. I want to fly. Okay, no, I'm not going to make you sing. So tell them about this song, this story for you, because Wynn and I go way back. Wynn, not that I've aged at all, you know, she continued to get old, and I have this sort of multi-universe kind of experience, multiverse reality where I don't age. And so back when she was 3 and 4 years old, she heard me telling this story at a birthday party. Yeah.
So Tom was the celebrity at my 3-year-old birthday party. What? I know, we're both like vampires, like we haven't aged a day.
You do look a little older than four.
I look a little bit older than three or four. I am 40 wonderful years now.
Wow.
Yeah.
It was
that far back. So thank you.
Oh, nice.
And so my mom, some of y'all know my mother, Mary, she had a cassette. And for some, there's nobody in here that just doesn't know what a cassette is, correct? Side A and side B of a cassette player. There's some young people in the back. It's okay. Have your parents explain it to you. So during my nap time, I would hear Tom's storytelling on this cassette on my little Sony red cassette player that I had in my bedroom, and this story was one of them, and I would fall asleep to the words, fly free from your cage. And I just love this song. I've always been kind of a free spirit, if you can't tell by just the general demeanor of my energy. My hair is a dead giveaway, okay? Curls cannot be controlled, don't try. You will lose that fight every day in every way. So, my mother actually never tried to control my curls, and it's probably one reason why I have the blossoming personality that I am today. So I listened to this song, and it's something that just kind of like stuck in my heart. Even when I was younger, my parents were divorced. I hated it when they called it a broken home. In one of my jokes now, I say it's wear and tear. it's an evolution, it's an existence of community and not believing that something is broken. You just want to be free. Whatever that cage feels like, whether it's sharing two homes, whether it's sharing custody, whether it's flying back and forth, I found a lot of solace in Tom's storytelling. And I grew up, and even when I graduated from Boswell High School out by Eagle Mountain, Saginaw Lake, my mom knew that I could not be contained in Fort Worth, Texas. She's like, you're always this cage bird. You're always this song that I hear. And sure enough, I flew from Fort Worth. And I went up and I played soccer, and I went up to St. Paul, Minnesota, and I played for the University of St. Catherine. And then from there, I've just always had this spirit to me of I come back home, I call Tom my lighthouse, because every once in a while I pull into port and he saves me from the rocks. And so I just keep on believing in myself. The nerve, right? I mean, the audacity I have to be me.
Let me chime in pick up those while you're at it, because we'll go to those in a minute. So, but let me chime, before you get to that, let me chime in with that, because really what you're bringing up is an important part about this story, and I think an important part about the text, okay? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to read the text again in light of this story, in light of what you just shared about what the story meant for you. And I used to travel around for years and years as a storyteller and a children's author, and that's how we crossed paths back when she was young. Jesus turned the Jews who claimed to believe him, if you stick with this living out my teachings, then you're going to be disciples for sure. You'll experience in yourselves the truth, and the truth will free you, which is an interesting idea, right? Because again, when we start seeing it's something different from us, that God and this truth are something other than us, then we kidnap it and we decide what that truth is that's going to set you free, right? As opposed to something else that's in all of us that connects us all by we call it the Imago Dei, the image of God or the ground of being, which is love. That kind of, there's something else going on that we are called to be freeing. And then he says a little bit further, but we're descendants of Abraham. See, they've already kidnapped it. Yeah, we belong to Abraham, so how can you talk about this? We belong to Abraham. That's the way you do it, Abraham. The Jewish faith, that particular lineage, that's the way it works. Doesn't work any other way. And Jesus says that anyone who chooses a life of sin is trapped in a dead-end life, a slave. I know you're Abraham's descendants, but I also know that you're trying to kill me, right? Because why? Why do we do that? Why do we resist the invitation to live more fully in relationship to others, right? And so what you're saying was that you didn't find, I mean, you heard the message from me, but you found the freedom within, and it continues to be a story now that you are the one witnessing to yourself. Yeah. You're not trapped by this cage.
I'm not trapped by the cage of my own being, if that makes any sense to anyone here. A lot of it's because my mother believes in me. So does my entire family, my friends, my support system. And I have this question here. What is the difference between the hero's journey and the heroine's? And we can do a little bit of yin and yang, female masculine energy for that one. But if you want to...
Can we?
We can.
Okay. Let's try that.
Just in general, how easy is it to believe a good-looking man with a full head of hair when he has a good business idea? Pretty simple, right? It just seems like a given. You're like, well, you clearly must know what's going on. You don't need Rogaine. Take my money.
That hurt. Was he 6'2" on top of that?
Probably. Okay. Quarterback of the high school football
team. Now I'm back in my cage.
Exactly.
Back in my cage. Okay.
When you look like me, or when you take any other sort of form, whether that is male, female, yin, yang, just, it's so easy to believe in the historical value of where we've typically placed our currency. It's very hard to believe and invest in somebody else's story that maybe doesn't look like you, or maybe their paintings aren't up on the walls and the halls of our institutions. And so for myself, I look different, right? I don't look like, I don't know, maybe the entrepreneurs that are on all of our Newsweek magazines and everything else, but I'm still forging ahead and I still have an amazing support system. But the yes and, which is the cornerstone of improv, yes is the agreement and is the contribution. That's the comma, yes and. So the difference between the hero's journey and the heroine's journey, I think, is that sometimes you really have to believe a little bit more in her. Whatever that feminine energy is, and I'm using her in a pronoun way, but I don't mean it in that singularity. You have to believe in them. Because that story, that narrative, that investment of currency may not look like it has historically. So that for me is the difference between the hero's journey and the heroine's journey. It's because that heroine is going to be something new.
Yeah, that's great. That's a great way to put it. Would we in the
Thank you. I am a phenomenally intelligent human being.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are. We'll have this will be a series of affirmations throughout the morning. So the heroine's journey is also that as you said, it's that willingness to, we call it the feminine energy or the feminine side of things. It's just a way of kind of designating two sides. We have the masculine energy, we have the feminine in all of us. But really that heroine's journey is looking at what's connective. Looking at what's connective between us, what's connective within us. Mm-hmm. And that's looking at what's seeking to be born in that mystery, because we've already, you know, it's easy to get back in our cage. Can you throw up this image? Can you throw the image up? I think this next one, I love this image if it's the right one. I can't remember what order I put. Yeah, I love that. I find your freedom offensive. Now, here's the thing, right? So we see the judgment happening all the time because we fall back into our cages. I fall back into my own insecurity. I'm not 6'2". I don't have a big full head of hair. I don't have a big successful career. I'm not making a lot of money. I've got all of these definitions that I've already put myself in my cage, right? I put myself in my cage. So I'm going to look out there and be angry or be jealous or be vindictive or be projective or whatever, when in reality, there's no cage, right? There's no cage. I've just placed the cage there. We find the Methodist Church going through the same thing right now as it's dealing with LGBTQ inclusiveness and such and issues. And the church is dividing over this issue of love, which is such a ridiculous issue to divide over, because they're sure that it's one thing or that it's another thing. They've already created a cage. I say they, we, I'll own up to the fact that we're all still part of the same family. We've created this cage from within which we can point our finger outside and go, you know, I find your freedom offensive, right? And so the challenge for us then, the invitation of the feminine, is to live with that fear and see what it is, as opposed to using that fear to stoke our fear. Do you see the difference? The masculine wants to claim control. And that works fine as long as you can control. You'll find, though, ultimately, that crowd gets smaller and smaller. Because you've got to find people like you who are willing to control like you. Otherwise, you want to control them, too. So it just keeps getting smaller. So this idea of entering into the feminine is this invitation to go into the difficulty. One more thing real quickly. You remember the parable of the wolf? The two wolves inside, a lot of you have heard that story. There are two wolves. You've got the hungry one that's got negative. There's this one wolf with negative attitudes and vindictive and judgmental. There's this other one with positive attitudes who's kind and generous, etc. And then the son looks at his grandfather and says, well, grandfather, if the two wolves inside me, which one survives? And the grandfather says, the one you feed. But the problem with that story is it fails to recognize they're fed, both of them are fed by the same source. They're both the same. And when we're willing to say, no, I don't want to, I'm going to resist that bad in me, what happens? We end up giving it more fuel. Do you remember the
Well, I have a counter to that idea.
Okay. I love counterintuitive. Yeah. I love counter ideas.
Yeah. Don't worry. Some men just are like, why is a woman talking? They just like literally the brains just shut down.
Yes and?
It's not. It's a either or in this situation. No.
Okay.
The counter to that, no, if we were to be in agreement, I do agree that there is two wolves inside you. My and the contribution underlying would be, what happens to any sort of wild animal or part of you, an existence self of being, when you don't pay attention to it. It becomes aggressive. It becomes hostile. It's mangy. The teeth are bared, and it comes out in like these violent spurts. So, for example, someone like me, to use your metaphor of two wolves inside me, I have two wolves inside me, and I try to be kind to both so that they don't compete with each other, that they don't see one as less than or more than, because otherwise one's going to get real gnarly. They're just going to start to just war with each other. So yes, they are fed from the same source, but for someone like myself who's trying to create something which hasn't ever existed before, I'm literally creating something from scratch with the help of my higher power. I have to feed both wolves because they're both drinking from the same well. And if I don't give attention to both wolves, one's going to become hostile. And even though the well-fed wolf will become kind and dominant and all that, having that alpha beta role inside of you, oh, that's a dangerous way in which to live, because then you don't know if you're making fear-based decisions or not.
So Wynn, let me ask you this. I think we're actually on the same track here. Mm-hmm. So you have both wolves. You got to pay attention to both wolves.
Yeah.
How do you feed the angry wolf? How do you pay attention to the angry wolf?
Sometimes you got to get real still and quiet. I'll share with y'all a story from the shutdown, because I was in New York during the beginning of the pandemic, really quickly, of how I learned to feed both wolves. So my prominent wolf is the wolf that is a performer. I absolutely love engagement. I love being in presence with people. This is my well right here. All of you are water, in which I love to drink straight from the source. You put this personality in an apartment shutdown in New York City, the mangy wolf came out. The one that cannot read quietly to herself, the one that constantly needs to conversate and need attention and all of it. And during the pandemic, during the shutdown, I actually started feeding that mangy wolf through online courses, through writing, through meditation, through a lot of telehealth sessions with my therapist. Just kind of beginning to calm that wolf and say, there, I'm going to give you a steak as well. I'm going to be kind to you. I'm going to give you presence in my life. And now here we are almost 3 years later, and I've been through the sketch writing curriculum of UCB, which I never wanted to do before, because why would you want to write words when you can just say them? Why would you want to put your thoughts on paper when you can just improvise them? I am someone that constantly was present with my verbiage and present with my scene partners, but you take away my presence, you take away my audience, you take away my scene partner, and the mangy wolf came out.
Yeah.
So yeah. That's how you feed both, is sometimes you have to have a life crisis, which maybe it was a pandemic, maybe it was something else for each
right,
of you,
yeah.
And you realize that you're not paying attention to that other part.
Well, I want to respond, but I think we're really on the same track. But before we do, let me see that question real quick. What is this one here?
See, yeah.
It goes, masculine, feminine here, we're related to left-right brain thinking. Again, is a masculine, feminine, hero, heroine related to left-right brain thinking? Are we wired to either? I will say this. I think we've talked about this in here a lot. We do get ourselves trained neurologically. We entrain ourselves into certain habitual patterns, right? And all of our emotions are linked to our neurology. So if we do something repetitively, then we're linking that neural network, that neural pattern. And so in order to change that, which is what you are doing, you have to intentionally sort of recognize it. You have to acknowledge it. You have to sit with it. And then you have to recognize it when you're into that pattern. Am I resisting here? Am I reacting? Is this at my same negativity that always comes out? Then once you notice that, then you stop. And we've talked about it. We use the Easter acronym of RISE, right? Instead of react, reflect. Instead of resisting, we pause, we reflect. And then we instead of insisting, we inquire. We begin to ask questions of what's going on here. And then instead of going for the status quo, which is reinforcing those old patterns, we allow space for this to be present. And then we bring life to that moment. We find new ways of doing things, so we begin to retrain the old patterns. So yes and no, they're not really separate. They're not separate like that. Mm-hmm. But it is that opportunity to see them as one and the same.
Yeah,
you know, and so when you're feeding the bad wolf, you're paying attention to the reality that they're both the same source. They're both coming from you, but you begin to pause and you begin to encourage that wolf to sort of sit back rather than to attack, essentially.
Correct. They're it both just takes time.
Like shame, when you experience shame, what mm-hmm. is shame but the desire to be more connected with others, the desire to be accepted, right? Mm-hmm. So shame, the opposite side of that is this longing to be accepted. If you see that they're both the same, they're just two sides of the same coin, then you are allowed to sort of sit back and go, what's really going on here whenever I'm feeling ashamed? Yeah. Then am I being accepted? You know, can I find my own self-acceptance? Guilt, the same thing, this desire to be a part of something bigger than myself that's good, but I always kind of feel guilty. Or greed, you know, again, this desire, this sense of which there's scarcity out there. I just have this sense that I'm not getting all my needs met. So they're all part of the same thing.
Yeah.
I want to make sure, Brad, there's no questions?
None yet.
None coming from online? All right. So let's wrap it up then. And what's the final thought that you're thinking?
My final thought. Let's see if I can make this cohesive train of thought here. So, y'all ever seen those videos on Facebook or Instagram of like the abandoned dog, like at the trash dump or that's been rescued and stuff like that? Spoiler alert: that is also shared within each of you. Because there's a part of you that hasn't been properly cared for that you might need to look at rehabilitating. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of courage to bring that dog and make it a house pet because you see it as wild. You see it as something that is in some ways kind of unapproachable because it's been so long untended. Untendered, I guess. I'm losing my words here. But just take the time, and you can actually see, I love those videos when they actually show the dog that has been rehabilitated and has finally, like, found its forever home, and the fur is growing back, and they're playing with kids in the backyard, because that is also you. That's also a part of you that just needs to be fed from the same source that you had that domesticated house pet that you were like, oh, this is my best version of self. Here it is, my well-trained dog, my Labrador. And then there's this wolf in the back that's just, again, long-toothed and gnarly and, you know, losing its hair. You're like, but that's not mine. And you're like, they both have tags on them that say they belong to this address. So I would encourage you to do some looking in your own wilderness and find the wolf that maybe you haven't invited inside the house because there is love there.
Yeah, that's good. So with that, the last, this Carl Jung quote up here, if you could pull that up there real quick to close with. The band can start coming on board here if they want to. Come on, step up here. One does not become enlightened by imagining figures of light, but by making the darkness conscious. The latter, however, is disagreeable and therefore not popular. That's a challenge for us. When Jesus says, you'd rather be captive to sin than to listen to me, and you want to kill me because I'm talking about loving one another, I'm talking about accepting your own love deep down within you and being able to see that in everybody else, the Samaritan, these other people, your enemies. And, I mean, when we begin to use language and kidnap language or kidnap Bible or kidnap our faith ideas and use them to justify our stance, you can be sure you're no longer paying attention to the divine connection between all of us. At that point, you're back paying attention to your own fear. You've created the cage, and you're just pointing outside the cage. So that's really this invitation, I think, of the journey that the heroine's journey is this invitation to start catching ourselves doing that. You don't change the world by taking a stance that's a cage, basically. You change the world by opening up that, stepping out into that messiness, mm-hmm. and then starting to ask questions of your own sense of discomfort and your own sense of what's possible. And then you start to see it in other people as well. I think that's what we were invited to. All right, well, thanks very much for letting us do this. This was, and thank you very much, Wynn LaRue.
You're welcome. I'm glad I made it on time.
Yeah. Very much an improvisational conversation, but I really appreciate it. All right,
yes,
Ben.
Thank you all very much for your
presence.
Send
us home. Close us out here.